Good morning. Before we begin, I would like to respectfully acknowledge the traditional owners on the land on which this event is taking place and elders both past and present. Good morning and welcome to this Partners in Technology briefing. Can I first say that this is the most compliant and well-behaved group that ever comes together within this area here. By 8:30, everyone is sitting down and are quiet. I emceed a similar group earlier this week, and we didn't get going until 10 minutes after the time. Everyone was standing, they were talking in amongst themselves. So I'm really happy that we can get today's event underway. My name is Andrew Spina. I'm the Assistant Director General for Digital Productivity and Services within the Department of Science, IT and Innovation. Just some housekeeping, the exits are at the back. The facilities are downstairs. In the event of an evacuation, just follow the instructions of the EDGE staff who are trained fire wardens. We'll move away from the building to the assembly area, which is the grassed area outside of the Queensland Art Gallery, unless otherwise directed. For your information, we are live streaming this morning's proceedings, so a warm welcome to those who are joining us online. This is going to be our last PiT briefing for the year in 2017. Our first briefing will be on the 31st of March. It will have a focus on health. Today's briefing features presentations from the Department of Transport and Main Roads, QUT, and DeCities Strategic ICT Division. As always, following the presentations, we'll conclude with a Q&A session which will take us through till around 10. We'll then adjourn to the foyer for networking and tea and coffee. I hope you can join us for that. Now to our first speaker. I'd like to introduce Mr. Martin Bradshaw, Chief Information Officer with the Department of Transport and Main Roads. Many of you will know Martin. For those of you who aren't so familiar, I'll just give you some information about Martin's career. More than 8 years of experience in the transport and technology industries, Martin is a dynamic and motivating leader with a strong focus on setting strategic direction and delivering significant change programs. This experience brings unique insight and expertise to his current position as CIO at the Department of Transport and Main Roads. Martin leads a team in excess of 400 staff and contractors and is currently responsible for delivering significant ICT programs aimed at improving customer experience and delivering better digital business outcomes for the department. Prior to his role as CIO, Martin was Executive Director Customer Technology at TransLink, where he was responsible for managing go-card ticketing and technology, real-time information, HASTIS scheduling, and open data systems, which include revenue collection of approximately $380 million in 14-15. In addition, Martin has broad management experience across both the private and public sectors, including Kellogg's, National Foods, and South Corp Wines. Please join me in welcoming Martin to the stage.
For whatever reason, I thought there were going to be about 50 people here. I was going to wear jeans and a polo shirt. I'm really glad I put a suit on. My name's Martin Bradshaw. For the record, I'm not Ron Burgundy, and I'm not a relation, relation of his. I am, however, supporting Movember, which I've been doing for about a decade now. So for those in the room who have colleagues who are doing Movember, you can look them in the face. It's not that scary. And I'd strongly encourage you to donate to them. If you haven't got a colleague that is doing that, please go to the Movember site and do a name search of Martin Bradshaw, make a donation. It's a great cause. Many of you have probably seen me speak briefly before. I've been in this role now for about 14 months, and to be honest, it's been one hell of a journey. Over that time, I've come into the organisation with a bit of a remit to, I guess, turn the organisation around from being very inward looking to more of an outward customer focused organisation. Around about half the leadership team is now new, and they've hit the ground running. I'll run through today, I guess, a little bit about what our strategies were, what we've delivered. I'll talk a bit around the ICT strategy and digital strategy that we now have in place. And I'll also talk a bit about where we're headed in the future as we move forward. I am a bit of a Luddite, so I will be flicking pages on my paper copy, so you'll have to excuse me on that front. So values and diversity. Obviously, this is a slide that is standard on our government packs, but it actually means quite a bit to me. We have, obviously, our five values across TMR. We also have a further seven principles in ITB in which we adhere to and hold ourselves accountable to. They do include principles around putting the customer at the heart of everything we do, but also principles around risk and accepting risk. And I'm trying to build a culture internally which understands that risk is part of your business, it's part of your day job. You need to understand it, you need to respect it. I also am proud of the work that we're doing with our work and welcome program. That is where we are taking on a number of people in a program who are, I guess, new Australians and giving them an opportunity to work productively and build their careers and stuff. So some really good work being done in TMR on that front. This slide is meant to make us look really impressive, but what it really shows is that we are a complex organisation. We have approximately 8,000 employees. I have currently around about 500 staff and contractors within ITB. We are a large ICT shop, but that does fluctuate with the workload for the business. We do support more than 100 sites across regional Queensland, as well as you can see here, you know, the road sector, rail corridors, ports, maritime safety, public transport across four different modes. We have the largest geographically integrated public transport network in the world. We are obviously responsible for significant revenue collection. More importantly, we're here to serve the 5 million or close to 5 million Queenslanders. And we do that every single day, 24/7. So this is an interesting one. We didn't go about the normal way. Normally you come up with a vision, you come up with your mission statement, then you go through your strategies, et cetera, et cetera. I felt early on that we didn't actually have enough information, enough understanding of what the business really wanted to undertake a vision and mission statement when I first joined. So as a bit of a catch-all, we came up with just information technology branch enabling the rest of the department. We have now a vision and a mission statement. We'll be releasing that early in the new year, and I think it's based on the fact that we finally understand the value we can add to the department, to the business, to the people of Queensland. So in the new year, I'll be releasing that and coming back out and communicating that. More importantly, we will also be doing a strategy review in December and releasing again in February. So. Unfortunately, what you're seeing is the strategies that we have been working on. They are important. Many will cross over, but I'll talk a little bit more about where we're going to head. In short, these strategies probably reflect where the organisation was in ITB. We had to rebuild the foundations. We were an organisation that had lost relevance within the department, and I'm not sure we were delivering for our customers across Queensland. So, as I said, new leadership team, a new focus on strategy, a new focus on the customer and how we can become a much more agile organisation. So as you look through that, that's clearly reflected. Improve the way we do business was actually just the fundamentals. Get the proper financial controls in place, get the proper project and program controls in place, make sure that we weren't squandering the taxpayers' money in Queensland. Improve regional ICT services. Anyone that works for TMR in a regional office has seen a significant degradation of their ICT performance probably about 3 years ago when we rolled out the Microsoft upgrade program. That has taken a lot of time and effort to turn that around. We have now fixed 15 of our primary sites. We have a plan over the next 8 months that will fix all of the remaining sites and get our staff productive again. It's been an important program. It's been well received, and we've done it in a very structured way. A lot of it is replacing old and aging infrastructure that hadn't been replaced over a fair period of time to deliver better business outcomes for TMR. We didn't have a contemporary customer engagement model. We didn't have an operating model of any standing, and our service catalogue was out of date. Again, coming back to the fundamentals, that reflects where the organisation was. And I'm proud to say that we've made a lot of movement forward on that front. Improve user experience. This is a big one for me. Every time one of our customers, and whether that be a staff member or a customer out there in Queensland, gets sent a link saying that you need to approve a transaction or undertake something on their iPad, and it comes up with an error message when they hit that link, that actually reminds them how crap we are at doing our job. So it was important to me that we turn that around. So we've got a really big focus on that, and we're starting to give our staff the tools they need to service their customers out in the field. Part of that is also a mobility strategy, which we now have in place. Secure and protect TMR's information and systems. You'll find something similar to that on everyone's strategic agenda. It is ever present. We receive a more spam email, in fact, 2 times more spam email than legitimate email every single day of the week. So it gives you a bit of an indication of what you're up against. And a constant battle, and as we say, it's not if, it's when, and how well we're prepared to not only, identify it, but also act on it. Improve ICT investment. There's another slide that will talk a bit about ICT investment in a second, but fundamentally we invest around about $70 million each year in new ICT projects, or I should say business projects that have a large ICT component. It's important for all Queenslanders that we maximise the value of that, that we're ensuring that we're focusing that investment in the right direction, that we are managing the governance around that investment, and we're actually delivering on the benefits realisation. So that's a large focus of what we've been doing. We've come a long way on that front, and we'll continue to do more. Contemporary as a service ICT delivery. This one always gets me in trouble in government, but the reality is we are focused on as a service. But we're focused on it so we can release our staff to work on higher value business activities. So it is a strong focus for us. The actual strategy is in draft form. It's in internal consultation within ITB at the moment. We'll be looking at probably doing external consultation on that sometime in the new year. But it's an important step of us progressing as an organisation. Improve TMR's data management and BI capability. I'm gonna put my hand up here and say I think we've failed on this one for the year. We've really struggled on this one. We're going to work harder again on this. We're going to redouble our efforts, but we haven't nailed this one yet. So we'll continue to work on it. Procurement and contract management reform. I think there are many people in this room that have been frustrated with procurement and contract management across government at various times, and for those of you dealing with TMR, I've no doubt you've been frustrated with us. We recognise that, we acknowledge it, and we're doing a hell of a lot of work to fix it. We are moving very quickly to a procure to pay, so we are ensuring that not only is our procurement simpler, easier and faster, but we are also making sure that we are paying on time. It's important. We are also moving to category management, and we had an external audit or review, I should say, done of our entire procurement and contracting area, and we'll be implementing all of the recommendations from that, which we've already commenced that process. So we are looking at a major reform there. My instructions to the team were simple. Minimal procurement effort that is appropriate. It's as simple as that. We need to move away from these large procurement activities that are adding little value and frustrating the vendors out there. improve workforce planning, development and people and capability. Goes a bit of hand in hand with the as a service as well. We need different skill sets within the organisation. We need to map that out and we need to give them the training to get there. And we're doing a lot of work on that front as well. We've also been doing a lot of work around succession planning and single points of failure so that we can create a more resilient organisation. So that's sort of predominantly the past, because we've delivered a lot of this already. And like I said, it was reflective of where we were as an organisation. That figure's actually wrong up there, and I apologise for that, but in usual sort of government ways, we have to put forward our speaking notes, you know, about 2 months earlier and get approvals and do all the rest of it. So apologies for that, but that's probably closer to 50%. And more importantly, through November, December and January, we hit around about 85% against that program. The 35 projects that are identified, and there's actually 36 of them, but the 36 projects that are identified are just those that we are monitoring and managing as a leadership team. There are in excess of another 200 projects and programs being run throughout the business. We have operational planning done all the way down to a unit level. Every staff member in ITB knows exactly what they have to deliver, when they have to deliver it, and the scope around that. So we've come a long way from that point of view. I haven't got it in here, but I wish I did. We do quarterly people pulse surveying of our staff. And I can tell you that when we restructured the organisation in ITB back in about February, March, I think we had a satisfaction rating of around about 20%. That satisfaction rating now is up around 70 to 80%. We have a dissatisfaction rating now of less than 20%. So not only have we turned the organisation around from the point of view of delivery, but we've actually turned the culture around, and that's really important to me. So we've come a long way. Working with our vendors. So we, and this is an aggregate across the length of the contract, so just to put in perspective, but we, you know, we manage more than 70 contracts with a value of $312 million. That will only increase. As we move more to as a service. We are currently in the final procurement activities around provision of CAGEN services. That has stacked up well, looks like a good way forward for us. It means that we're not contracting individual contractors, we're getting that in delivered as a service. It means that we can scale up and down rapidly to meet our customers' needs. So that's where we're going to be headed as we move forward. And as I said earlier, there's around about $70 million in additional investment each year, which is business projects with significant ICT components. This one here, and despite my best efforts, they will not put the business analytics in a big bubble for me, but effectively, the ICT strategy, the digital strategy, and the business analytics strategy are key and central to our direction as we move forward. When I started in this role, we didn't have an approved ICT strategy. There was no digital strategy on the radar, and there was no business analytics strategy on the radar. These are key to driving our organisation forward beyond ITB into the rest of TMR. Now the ICT strategic plan, and I do apologise, I went on the TMR website this morning and I noticed that this wasn't actually there, so I'm having that resolved today. You'll find, hopefully by tomorrow, the ICT strategy and the digital strategy will be up. The ICT strategic plan, enabling enhanced customer experience. It's about ensuring we have the supporting ICT systems and services to enable the delivery of a complete digital experience. This is a plumbing. This is obviously the mode one from a Gartner point of view. Leading technology innovation, embracing best practice ICT concepts and new technologies to enable business improvement. We've moved to a much more agile organisation. Originally in the structure we had an agile team, but we now call that the digital business team. And I'll talk about that in a minute. Enabling connected and accessible services, providing facilities to enable connections to staff and partners supporting one TMR. if you're in a regional office and you're trying to do Skype, there was, you know, probably a 1 in 2 chance that it wouldn't work. We have now resolved that issue. We've rolled out not only from a network point of view improvements, but we've also put the hardware and infrastructure into the regional offices that enable them to properly engage. Contemporary flexible business ICT systems ensure that our ICT systems are easily adaptable to change. I think many of you will know about our licensing and registration system called Trails. It is an ancient device, whilst it still keeps moving, it doesn't necessarily enable what we're looking at there. So we're looking at options around that, including putting a middleware across the top of it. Dependable and sustainable ICT delivery. We are doing a lot of work on our DR capability and also reviewing all our infrastructure. I think there's significant investment that we need to make to update that infrastructure. Our productive workforce using ICT-enabled enterprise tools and technologies. I guess an interesting thing about TMR, I think we've actually only got, I could be wrong here, but I think we've got about 2 apps in TMR, which is a bit of a sad indictment of where we are from an ICT point of view. We've got the MyTranslink app, I know we've got the RegoCheck app, but we're doing a lot more work on that front. Then we go to the digital strategic plan. This is where I get a lot more passionate. It's probably more my side of the business, to be completely honest. We started a digital program in 15-16. I managed to scrape together enough money to pull together a team concept for 4 months with a number of deliverables. Those deliverables including working prototypes in leading edge technology. And to their credit, that team did an outstanding job. From that, we doubled down on the investment in 16-17. And I can tell you now we'll double down on that investment again in 17-18. This is the stuff that's leading edge in some cases in Queensland, in other cases in Australia, and definitely leading edge in the world with a couple of examples. Part of this particular digital strategic plan is about changing the culture within the organisation. Anyone who saw the Gartner stuff on this probably a couple of years ago, they were talking about which way do you do it? Do you try and change the culture across the organisation, or do you create a specialist team that goes in and does the work? You have to do both from our point of view, because that digital team will influence the rest of the organisation. Our plan is within 2 years to no longer need that digital team in place. Because we will have influenced the culture across the organisation and put in place the changes that are required. That includes things like the enable disruption component, which is the removing the barriers to unleash digital potential. That means changing the way we do procurement, changing the way that we manage projects, changing the way that we finance projects. Changing the way that we report on projects. So there are many elements to this particular one in there. Power connections is obviously about how we work with academia, local government, and our vendors on that front. Interesting enough, on this particular program we are doing work on, and that's probably, I've probably got it down here a little, we are doing a lot of work on sensor technology. We are doing a lot of work on authentication, doing a lot of work on biometric. Use of biometrics is one factor of two-factor authentication, trying to get away from it, people needing to have a username and password. And we're doing a lot of work around smart forms. And believe it or not, we've even got 3 robots at the moment. We're still figuring them out. So where to from here? If you were to look at the strategies that we came from, they were very internally focused. And what I think you'll find is our strategies that we'll release in 2014 will be very much, 2017, going backwards in time, will be very much externally focused. It will be very much trying to remove cost from our business so that we can reinvest it for our business solutions and for our customers. We will be looking at Office 365. There is no decision on that yet. We will be looking at VDI. It's important for the productivity of our staff in the field. The VDI, as an example, we have staff in remote locations that may, at the end of the day, have to drive several hours back to the office to undertake activity. It's not productive, it's not viable, it's not a good outcome. SharePoint Online. Based on my background, integrated smart card platform, and can I emphasise this is not government policy. This is just me having a look at what are the opportunities between the smart license and go card and other applications, including authentication. However, from my point of view and from the early investigations, it does stack up. Transactional services improvement program, very much trying to upgrade the technology that we use within our transactions across the board. We now no longer pay people with checks. Anyone that knows what it costs to get a check produced in government knows that we save significant money just on that. And again, it's about making sure that we can streamline the services internally so people can be really focused on what they're there to deliver. As a service strategy, talked about that, improving ICT performance, that's inherent in everything we do. The ICT strategy action plan is drafted, we'll be releasing that shortly. TMR digital program, I've talked about that, it's about making sure we've got roadmaps across all areas of our business. Rapid prototype development, digital platforms, authentication, integration layers, electronic forms, digital capabilities, and a lot of work on sensor technology. It's very much a focus for us at the moment. Procurement and contract management reform, we'll have that bedded down. And business analytics, an area that we haven't performed well in, but we will redouble our efforts on that front. So thank you very much for that. I know I'm not the main act here today. I'm sure there's other speakers who are the key, but I do appreciate your time, and hopefully it's given you a bit of an indication of where we've been, but more importantly, where we're heading. Thank you.
Thank you, Martin. Look, it appears as though there's a hell of a lot that's happening within transport and main roads. And it might be that we may be able to convince Martin to come back once the strategy is developed for next year and to present on that as well. So our next speaker is Mr. Chris Bridge. It's been a long time we were reflecting that QUT has actually presented to this group. In fact, we can't remember when that was. Some of you in the audience might. Chris is the Director of Information Technology Services for Queensland University of Technology. He holds positions as a member of the board of ARNET, Australia's Education and Research Network Telecommunications Provider, the board of QCIF, Queensland Cyber Infrastructure Foundation, and is the Vice President of the Council of Australian University Directors of IT. Chris has over 20 years ICT private sector experience across a broad range of industry sectors. Much of his experience has been gained in professional services and consulting roles responsible for systems integration, outsourcing, and business development. Chris draws upon lessons from a diverse career that has seen him serve more than 7 years in the higher education sector, responsible for major ICT shared services programs and leadership in digital transformation. Driven by innovation and strong business engagement, Chris strives for excellence in providing staff and students with digital platforms to see them succeed at many levels. Please welcome Chris Bridge.
All right, good morning everyone, and thank you for the invitation. It certainly has been a long time, and I was just reflecting that I've certainly never had the opportunity to address this forum, and very happy to give everyone here a bit of an update as to what we're doing. Firstly, I thought we'd just have a bit of a look at a little bit about QUT and to give a little bit of a refresher. We're now hitting around the 50,000 student mark, which is a pretty impressive number. The number just keeps growing every year. I was asked earlier, how is QUT going? I'd have to say that there is no downtime anymore. The university is always on. It's a 7x24 operation. Students do most of their work at night, I think, if you look at the online stats. 50,000 students has made up around 15 to 16% of international students, so it's a pretty high percentage. There's also around 12,000 postgraduate students, and if you look at the trends of what's happening with students and study, the postgraduate market and the typical master's degree, if you like, is in somewhat of a national decline. And so as I go through the presentation, I just wanted to convey some of the industry trends that are going on and how universities need to look at those trends and respond to it. And it certainly points to an increasing level of flexibility, not only in the products and courses, but also how that information is served to such a broad student base. In terms of the successes of what QUT is achieving, there's a very, very huge focus around very strong industry engagement, strong industry partnerships. I'll talk a little bit further about the need for strong industry engagements in research in particular. The business school, you may not be aware, is a Triple Crown certified business school, which means it's in the top 1% of all the business schools worldwide. And when we look at the rankings are very, very important to universities. And if we look at the ones that QUT is particularly interested, not only the Xiao Tong Index in terms of the top 300, but also the Times Higher Education rankings is number 28 in terms of out of the top 150 universities, it's number 28 in universities under 50 years old. So to set a little bit of the scene, I like to start from the corporate strategy, so to speak. Where is QUT heading and what's its posture? I took a few excerpts from this. I won't read the slide in detail, but effectively what it's saying is that we're young and we're bold, and we really mean what we say when we're a university for the real world. That is not a marketing slogan. It is built into the DNA of how we like to drive the strategy for the development of the courses, the development of all of our internal services, and how we'd like to make sure that we're bringing the outside in all of the time. I'll talk maybe some examples later about how sometimes our students like to test our network in the real world, and we do appreciate their learnings, and we like to fix things as a result of having those tests done for us. But basically this blueprint, the new blueprint, is just being released. It is available on the external web now, and it's a very, very transformative and assertive statement now about how we're really serious about transforming the way we deliver education to actually meet the needs of our students and to increase the global reach, effectiveness and impact of research. From a technology standpoint, this particular iteration of the blueprint has never before had so much content related to the reliance of the university on digital capabilities and how that can be seen as an enabler and a transforming agent to assist our corporate strategy. So, a bit more on sector trends, and I'll explain a little why this is important later. But we have done a little bit of work, and I don't think for those that have been working with higher education that any of these things should be a big surprise. But the way we look at the big sector trends is in through these four lenses. In relation to digital transformation technology, the things that we're most concerned about is really the ubiquitous nature of the availability of knowledge. If you were to talk to a student today about how they learn, probably one of the first things they do is they go on the web and they find out, how do I do Accounting 101? Where's the best content? They don't necessarily go to the content that's been provided to them in terms of a learning process. It is just the ubiquitous availability of online knowledge that is really driving some of that transformative change. As a consumer, we all have an increasing level of expectation around how we consume our online services. We want to be more mobile. We want the information anywhere, anytime. If you can think about the traditional practice 700 years ago of how lectures used to be delivered up here at a lectern, notes, slides, not a lot has changed, but it is now changing incredibly rapidly. We're seeing differentiated players in the market delivering online education in blended formats and different formats. It is available globally. There are choices out there, more and more choices out there for students to consume the products that they want. And of course, IT generally is driving a lot more efficiencies than we've ever had before. Around amplified expectations, the government, only in yesterday's financial review, there's reports about next year's budget, 20% less. That's been on the cards for some time now. But when those sorts of changes are happening at the federal level in terms of supporting students in terms of their education, it means there's a higher burden on the student. And it also means universities need to look at how they fit, financially fit, to be and competitive in delivering good outcomes for students at a competitive price. Those price changes increase the expectations everywhere. If the student is paying more, it may be the same product as they were consuming before, but the expectations are all going up. And typically our students are telling us they don't want to see everything online. They see that as potentially walking away from delivering a highly engaged learning experience to help them get their outcomes. That's not why students come to QT, in terms of just consuming information online. There's also a higher expectation around research, applied research and research impact and research outcomes. And that's happening globally. In terms of global competition, it's a competition for students, it's a competition for, you know, for great staff, and it's also a competition for funding. The level of funding in terms of research, percentage of research coming to universities compared with private sector in Australia is very low from the private sector contribution compared to what we might see internationally. So the competition for research funding is actually a global competition. And in terms of partnerships, this is a really important aspect. QT has developed some fantastic partnerships and seeks to develop higher levels of deep partnerships with industry in many areas. The win-win outcomes are quite significant. So moving quickly now, I want to just cover a little bit about what's been happening and that we've created a digital roadmap, which I'll go through also in a pretty quick way. But the digital and physical transformation has been happening anyway. And I'll just go through a couple of those examples. So people that have come along to QT may have seen that photo on your left of the cube. So it's a fantastic learning and teaching facility, as well as this type of interactive display is also being used for research. So we're seeing the integration of digital and physical changes coming together to be able to do things in different ways. On the right-hand side of your screen, every classroom now has the same technology, and we're moving more and more to flexible patterns of how that technology is used. So no more of this deep lecture theatre style anymore. Those are actually being converted in the near future in our master plan for the physical environment. More and more of these modular classrooms about how we engage students in their learning and in also using blended learning pedagogies. So a little bit towards our digital roadmap. We've spent a fair bit of time internally, significant time internally, engaging 70 to 80 of our most senior researchers and senior learning and teaching academics in the production of a digital roadmap. The IT contribution to this has been maybe 5%. The rest of it is all what we'd say from the business. It is in the language of the university for the university. It is not an IT plan. And it really does represent our vision. What we've done is mapped it very, very closely to the QT blueprint. And the QT blueprint is our corporate strategy. There's three spheres of activity in that strategy. One around learning, students learning and teaching, as you'd expect, research and innovation, and then people, culture and sustainability. The key areas of focus around learning and teaching is around how to make sure that we continue to produce employable graduates. Number one. Students that come are looking typically for an outcome at the end. There are a range of different types of students, perhaps those that like the learning experience and continuing academic endeavour. But one thing we're very focused on is the graduate employability at the end and the ways in which we help achieve those successful outcomes. research and innovation. It's around how we help use digital technologies to help accelerate the impact of research, and also to help researchers become more productive in their research endeavours. And with people, culture and sustainability, the sustainability ones should be a no-brainer. How can we help make the place a whole lot more efficient, take the aggravation factor of poor business processes out, and make sure that we're doing things in the right way, but also how do we help use technologies to be really digitally progressive? How do we help enable digital connections between alumni and students, between students and students, between staff in terms of their own collaboration with their peers globally? So a little bit about each domain. Each of these slides, I believe, is being made available, but effectively we've developed very strong vision statement around how digital technologies will be used to support and underpin the corporate blueprint strategy. And we've developed some principles along the way. One of the interesting parts of developing the digital roadmap was to really test some things. And one of the things that was really a terrific observation out of this was that we came up with a statement that we'll put the learner and the academic at the centre of all we do. The word academic was taken out by senior management. No, we're going to be putting the learner at the centre of all we do. So you can see from an IT standpoint, sometimes you think, well, I want to make sure everyone is successful in what they're doing in their work. But there was a very distinct focus around making sure the student always is at the centre of what we do in terms of supporting them. Then in terms of the digital roadmap, we've identified a number of initiatives. Enhancing our core capabilities, improving the learner experience, and increasing our flexibility and agility. Our core capabilities, learning management system capabilities, the ability to be able to access the knowledge you need in the device you need anywhere, anytime, is another of those type of capabilities. Improving the learner experience, how do we best support blended learning? What's this flipped classroom all about? What do we need to do to support that? What's adaptive learning? How do we use analytics to be able to track students that may not be succeeding in their chosen course? How do we identify them early and be able to have the right intervention and the right services at the right time to help them be successful? And by the way, in that area, I think QT was one of the most successful early universities to adopt analytics. And we probably saved nearly 400 to 500 students a year that may have just dropped out. Increasing our flexibility and agility. These are real digital initiatives to support how do we deliver more flexible timetables. Is the three-year degree of the future continuing to be the three-year degree of the future? Are we going to be looking at a competency-based model? Are we looking to deliver different types of courses over different times of the year? So there's a lot of underpinning technical technology capabilities that will need to be looked at to be able to address those kinds of changes. But there's also a fairly big corporate change required to do that. In terms of researchers, again, thinking about who the end client is, we are putting the research staff and the research students and our partners at the centre of what we do. And so there's a whole range of things that then come into focus for us around how digital technologies help support that. Part of what is seen to be successful in research for the future is about transdisciplinary collaboration. Could be the mixture of psychology and IT to produce research impacts that have higher impact than one discipline or one domain on its own. How do we help make sure researchers can connect and to identify opportunities to be able to produce outcomes that are really unique and can really differentiate QT from the rest of the research being produced on a global scale? So part of that are technologies that can really help identify and amplify researchers, their impacts, their publications, their citations. All of these things feed ranking, of course, and then helping them to be more productive in the research that they undertake. Some examples of that might be the reuse of intellectual property that's developed in one research project being used on another. For example, we have a lot of research in unmanned aerial vehicles. that kind of technology can be used in agriculture. It can be used in utilities industries in terms of flying across and inspecting power lines. There's a whole lot of reuse of IP in that area. Another one is motion eye cameras. Our education faculty might look at motion eye cameras to understand how students learn. That motion eye camera can then also be used into different technologies. We have one of the best robotic vision research areas in the world. Around people, culture and sustainability, the big challenge. Getting a group of people to understand how digital technologies can really add value to this particular part of a corporate strategy was a challenge. But when you start peeling back and say, how can digital engagement between citizens be leveraged, be utilised to their benefit, to QUT's future benefit, you start to get a lot of really interesting ideas. Some of those out there ideas might be, how do I find out that a graduate that has just finished at QUT has got the job of their choice? Do we connect with a LinkedIn profile and get an instant update that they've finished their law degree and now they've got a job at a major law firm? Fantastic. How do we then connect with that person over time to make sure that their education remains relevant and up to date? It's a bit like software sometimes. You know, if I was to release, you know, version one of a student, and then in 1 or 2 years' time when the course gets upgraded, how do I upgrade the student? So those are the sorts of thinking that's going on around what is the relevance of lifelong education and how do we make use of digital technologies to make those kinds of connections more relevant. Just a little bit. So in terms of our investment in digital technologies, just to point out just a couple of successes by following the strategy. Recently, we've been the gold winner of an Intranet and Digital Workplace Award through a deliberate focus around improving the staff experience with their corporate systems and by completely transforming the whole intranet environment at QUT. One of the big challenges was information, a knowledge-based environment. Information was housed in so many different silos, hard to find things, hard to navigate. Staff were always using Google search to find things. But through this whole process, we've completely redesigned through some principles around personalization, putting that staff at the center of how they consume services and information, and then from there being able to better serve. The second area was an ITSMF award for the whole service desk in terms of how we deliver the service the first time to those that are calling into a service desk. And so there's a couple of areas where we've just made those recent investments and been recognised international award and a national award on those two fronts. So I think I'm just within time now and maybe help catch up a little bit. But I just want to say thank you for your time this morning, and hopefully this has given you a good overview about what's happening in our sector and how QUT is responding to some of those strategic challenges. So thanks very much for your time. Good.
Thank you, Chris. And just as a reminder, Chris and Martin will join Dallas shortly for a Q&A session. So our final presentation this morning is from my colleague Dallas Stower. Dallas is the Assistant Director General of the City's Strategic ICT Division and has significant senior ICT leadership experience across a range of roles and organisations in over 30 years in the ICT industry. As a member of the City's Board of Management, Dallas has responsibility for SciTech ICT, SciTech Information Brokerage, ICT Strategic Sourcing and ICT Strategic Projects, including the One William Street Project and Government Wireless Network Program. Prior to his current role, Dallas was the General Manager of SciTech, which he transformed into a more sustainable business. Dallas was Executive Director of the Telecommunications and Digital Economy Coordination Office, where he led the government's telecommunications and broadband strategy. Dallas was also Chief Information Officer at Queensland Rail from 2001 until early 2009. Please join me in welcoming Dallas.
Okay, thanks Andrew. I've got the last leg here, so I've probably not the most glamorous subject, but probably a very important subject. So I just want to give you a quick update about where we're at with the GITC refresh. So just, I think the last time that we did an update was back in about March, when we talked about our achievements and what we'd done from stage one. So I want to take you through where we're at today. But before I do so, and I'm just going to give you a quick recap in terms of what this is about. So I guess, again, reminder that the main thing we're trying to do here is come up with the right contracting framework for ICT procurement in Queensland. So to come up with something which is better for government and more simplified and more effective for industry as well. So in doing that, the objectives that we have put in place for this new ICT contracting framework is to reduce the cost of doing business to government, to enable simple and fast procurement. And you might have noted in Martin's presentation, a strong focus of agencies, TMR, wanting to do that. To provide protection for contracting parties and to allow contracts to be formed for emerging and more innovative ICT products and services and ways of delivering ICT. So just again, refresh. So we did a review. The outcome of the review was that we're going to follow up with a three-stage refresh process to develop and implement a new ICT contracting framework. Stage one was completed in last year, in 2015, where we had a small group of industry and government stakeholders shape, you know, the direction of the general and comprehensive contracts. We commenced stage two. The early part of that stage two was a consultation and engagement process where we work with industry to co-design the engagement process, and that's followed a series of workshops that we've conducted over the last few months to actually get into the contract forming process itself. So just a recap in terms of where we're at with the general and comprehensive contract. So what we've done from July until what's coming up to December. So over the last few months, the focus has been on working with industry and government to refine and finalise the proposed new framework. So one of the key things that we've always said is we want to do a lot of consultation. So we've spent a lot of time in terms of working with industry to do that so that we can come up with a framework that hopefully we can all all agree on in terms of moving forward with. We partner with BDO to facilitate a series of workshops to undertake that activity. So we've done three contract workshops so far, six module workshops, and with a view to finalising the general and comprehensive ICT contracts. The stakeholders involved in that have been a selection based upon a cross-section of people from industry, from associations from industry, from government, from industry organisations themselves, with across a range of disciplines, from ICT to procurement and to legal disciplines as well. The feedback from those workshops have been provided to a project board that have addressed any of the policy issues that have come out of those workshops. So they've considered that, the program board has considered those policy issues and then fed that back into subsequent workshops that have taken place as well. And I'll outline what some of those policy issues are that have come through in a moment. So I've got to the point, done the workshops, and we're now in the process of drafting the contract details themselves, and these drafts are due to go back out to consultation with industry in early December, and then we have a view to leave that out until we'll finalise that feedback in early February. Very cognizant that we've got the Christmas New Year break coming up, so we're allowing a reasonable period of time for the drafting draft contracts to be out there for consultation and feedback. We also have an as-a-service module that's required additional input from stakeholders, mainly due to that being a sort of a new service arrangement and needs a little bit more focus than some of the other modules which have probably been pre-existing for some time. And we'll continue to engage on the as-a-service modules through into early next year, and we'll do a similar process with the telecommunications module as well. Okay, just moving on to the accreditation model then. So consultation workshops were held in October and November again, providing opportunity for, again, a large cross-section of stakeholders to to work out what we're going to do in terms of accreditation and where we would take that in terms of the future. There were three workshops that were completed and engaged over 32 stakeholders. These workshops looked at the role, the purpose of an accreditation model in the future, whether there would need to be the option to look at a tiering approach to accreditation, what data is required to be collected, what assessment criteria would need to be used, how to make sure that the quality and currency of data was kept up to date so it was relevant for government procurement people undertaking procurement activities, what was the role of a central authority in that accreditation process, what funding model might be required for that in the future, what the ownership model should be, all those sorts of things. So the outcomes and consultation of those workshops and feedback will be provided and presented to the project board next week to review and to give some future direction on where that that pathway goes. The guidelines for supplier terms and conditions. So this is one of the things we'd also talked about, the circumstance in which agencies would use vendor terms and conditions. So we distributed to stakeholders draft guidelines as to when and what circumstances they would be used and what conditions. And we've done some piling of that. So there's a consultation period that has now ended and stakeholder feedback is being collated and reviewed. And the final guidelines for using supplier terms and conditions are being drafted and again will be released early in the new year, again following going to the project board for its final endorsement. So I did say I was going to talk about the role of the project board and what it's been doing. So as I mentioned, these workshops happen, there are policy issues that might come up, they go to the project board for consideration. And there have been a range of issues that have come up that the project board has provided direction on. And they include that compliance with the contracting framework should be mandatory, that general contract conditions will not be negotiable, but additional provisions may be included on a contract by contract basis, that the city will be the custodian of the framework. We need some kind of central body to keep it refreshed and update as we go along if there are new and different ways of procuring services or new services, whatever that might be. A lot of conversation around intellectual property, and the view there was that intellectual property provisions that are published in the Queensland Public Sector Intellectual Property Principles version 2, got that right, will underpin the IP provision for contracts. However, contracts won't stipulate a default IP contract position, so that'll be up for the people in undertaking the contract is what to do with IP. The board also, there was some consideration of what modules would need to be as part of the new framework, and decision was made that telecommunication services will be included and that there will be new modules for managed services and ICT professional services. Okay, so where to from here? So as mentioned, workshops, the drafting's been happening in the comprehensive contracts. That'll be released for consultation and review in early December, left open until February. We'll finalise that. Once we've got that finalised, when we reach consensus and agreement with all the stakeholders, then the hard bit starts, and that hard bit is stage three, which is the change. And how do we embed the change? How do we educate people in terms of the new contracting framework? So we've started to do some work there, and we're starting to consult with agencies to develop some of those change plans across whole of government, and likewise we'll do the same thing with industry as well. So we need to make sure that to this to be effective and a good outcome at the end of the day, we need to embed those changes and make sure that we follow through on what we said we're going to do. And finally, I just want to say a thank you to some of our legal partners out there. So over the more than about 12 months now, we've been running a range of forming ICT contract information sessions for government. So the people on the board there are some of the legal firms that have been providing that to free of charge to government. That's been, it's been highly successful and it's been well attended by government as well. So I'd like to thank all those involved for doing that. And I'd also sort of finally like to thank the commitment from both government and industry in the process to develop this new ICT contracting framework, And again, I guess it's a bit of an example of where we can work together to get a great outcome for Queensland. Notwithstanding, I understand there's been some very robust discussions in a lot of those workshops, but at the end of the day, if we can get a constructive outcome that works both for government and for industry, then that's great. So again, thank you for your support. So my last slide there is, if there's any questions, happy to take that during question time. But if you want to also ask other things via email, then there's an email address there, and a lot of the material around the refresh and review is on the website as well. So avail yourself of that as well. So thank you. I said it's going to be quick. Thank you.
Okay, I'm going to now ask Martin and Chris to join Dallas on the stage. And we have a number of roving mics, so really it's over to you for any questions that you might have for our presenters. Now, I know that there are some questions. Here we go. Thank you.
I'll put my hand up since nobody else did. Hi, it's Gavin Kennedy here from QCIF. I'm interested, thank you very much to Martin and Chris with regards to your digital strategy. I'm interested to learn about your open data strategy, particularly the sharing of open data and the mechanisms to do that, not so much the policy, but you know, there's a lot of people in the community who would like to get access to your sensor data and to your, I guess, your student demographic data. So yeah, want to learn about that.
Thank you. Yep.
I think we're pretty proud in TMR. I think we're the second highest number of data sets within government at the moment in open data. We had another open data showcase earlier on in the year. More importantly, at that point in time, I managed to get a number of my colleagues to release some of the go-card data sets, which is obviously fairly important, and there's a couple of changes to those data sets I'd like to see made and released again. Currently they're trip-based. I'd like to see a bit more around the linking the journey-based. Some privacy issues we have to deal with there, but I think they're not insurmountable. In regards to the sensor data, that's in particular what I'm focused on. At the moment, we are looking at identifying flood data and water data when it comes to bridges, culverts, low-lying road space. Now, whilst that data is important to TMR, the highest value is if we can have that for open data and inform people immediately around what their transport options are, and hopefully stop people making bad choices crossing flooded roadways and bridges. So very much focused on that front, and always happy to see any requests for data sets, and if we can release them, we will.
And Chris, I'm sure we'd be interested in QUT's view on this as well. Yeah.
I think, is this on?
Yeah.
I think the not as close to the to open data initiatives as perhaps I would like to be able to be best to be able to respond to your question, but I can talk about what I do know. We support our researchers in being able to publish their data as part of publications, and they use a variety of facilities to do that. There are national entities funded by the federal government in terms of the standards for publishing information and being able to find it. There's tools to be able to find data. And increasingly for researchers, it's really important that, you know, in terms of their own citations, that citation count can increase if their data is found and it's been used in a productive way on a global basis. So that's been our main focus, I think, from my knowledge. My own knowledge of being able to publish any other data sets around attributes of the university, it's there's no particular initiative that my department is involved in terms of publishing any of that kind of data. Typically, student data and other sorts of things is available through annual reports, so all of that's freely available, but there's a lot of information in that area that's actually private and confidential. And so, you know, we hold that very dearly, and we protect that very dearly because of a lot of the association with particular students. So mainly the focus is research publications, citations, and the data that supports research, and the tools and the facilities that we put in place to help enable researchers to be successful in that regard.
Look, I must also take the opportunity, whilst transport and main roads are second on the score leaders, the city is actually first. Between the two of us, we're neck and neck. I think it's also important to state that there's a very important relationship Queensland Government has with ODIQ here in Queensland, and there will be a big focus on the quality of open data, the frequency that we provide. Queensland in the recent GovHack Awards, I think that our entrants won over a third of the national prizes, and Queensland were identified, I think, as the number one state in terms of participation in that GovHack event. So open data is sort of alive and well, but there's a hell of a lot more that we can do here. Another question? Yep, okay, thank you. Yeah, it's Mike's coming. We might just wait until it's here. Thank
you. G'day, my name's Christopher Biggs. I'm a consultant in the IoT space. Martin, you mentioned smart devices and bringing transport and licensing together. Can you talk about anything that transport might be doing in the IoT space in terms of getting sensors out in the transport, opening the data to people?
Yeah, look, it's an interesting one. I mentioned briefly the sensor work that we're looking at around that flood monitoring and that road closure type piece. It's only recently that we've seen the technology come down to a price point where it's viable, to be honest. And in particular, we're doing a lot of work around encouraging the telcos to ensure that they have satellite-capable sensor technology, because if you have a look across Queensland, you know, a large part of our infrastructure is not in 3G or 4G covered areas. And that has happened. That particular one that we're looking at the moment, we have over 3,000 bridges across Queensland. Most of those are in regional or rural areas. However, we inspect every bridge every year, so it does give us an opportunity to look at sensor technology and rapidly roll that out. One of the things that we are key with all of our contracts and agreements, particularly around the proof of concept side with sensor technology, is around the open data piece. We insist upon it. And we're also obviously looking then how we can link in other data sets, including, I was talking to my counterpart at the Bureau of Meteorology recently, and about how we then bring that into play. And then, you know, obviously the long-term aim for us is about that predictive side of it. So if we know that a particular bridge goes underwater at a certain point, then we might be able to forewarn residents in an area that, you know, within, you know, a reasonable accuracy, how long they've got to make their decisions about what they do. Look, the opportunities are endless on the IoT part. Right now, we're going through the proof of concept piece, and then we'll be broadening to the business. The business needs to tell us the use cases. Our job is to show them the technology and prove that it can work.
Okay. Another question over there.
Kirsty Garrett from Objective. Just to change tact a little bit, Dallas, you're feeling lonely there. With respect to the transition and change to GITC 6, two questions. One is for those that are currently on a GITC 5 form of contract, what will be the process of engagement for those vendors to move them forward, and I guess the negotiation if they're up for the changes? But also if they're signatories to certain modules, but they would like to expand and enhance that to software as a service or managed services. So how will that occur from 1 July?
Is that on? So if I understand your question, you're asking what's the transition process for people who are currently on an existing contract to new. I think we're really focusing on when new stuff goes out, we're focused on getting people on new contracts. If there is additional services and existing contract which is a new module, then we would work with that vendor to see where that's applicable, but we're not necessarily saying we're going to go back and retrofit everything in the past necessarily. So when those things come up for renewal, we'll look at that. That's to go back and do that's a major undertaking.
Okay. Any other questions? Question there in front of you. Yep. Thanks.
Thank you. Hello. It's Hugh Peterkin from Business Analysts. The question I've really got for all of you is around the funding mix going forward on the programs of work you've been talking about. So we've heard a lot about some new initiatives about doing things a very different way. Does that mean that the traditional model where you spend 70% of your funds on running the business and 30% on innovating is changing going forward, or are you still going to be spending the vast majority of funds on maintaining that legacy infrastructure?
Okay, that's a really good question. I mean, the first is the assumption that it's 70 and 30. I suspect it's more than 70, but who wants to take that first? Martin? Yeah.
Yeah, no, look, absolutely. I'd love it if it was 70-30. let's be honest. We're doing a lot of work right now around cost optimization focused on that mode one. You have to be honest about the current economic position and you have to deal within that. So our focus is very much seeing how we can rob Peter to pay Paul. Peter being mode one and Paul being mode two. We do that in a number of different ways, but we're also getting better at attracting funding from the point of view of we've got stronger arguments to make within our own organisations. Part of the reason that I self-funded the initial digital team was to show what you could do with a small number of staff. Running in a very different way and proving what you could deliver. And that worked. I can tell you now that for the first time in my knowledge within TMR, when I put forward the business case after the initial period, each Deputy Director General agreed to co-fund the entire project out of their budgets. That's unheard of. We need to be better at proving what we can do, and we need to do it better, and that's my focus at the moment.
What the ratio is. we've had a pretty good look at that, and I think it's a great question, because I think every IT director, CIO out there would have this question in their mind as to the increasing cost of maintenance and support and the reducing capital available for transformation. So that's on all of our minds. The percentages vary a little bit all the time. And so for us, there is an enormous amount of focus right now in terms of university transformation, as per the second slide I put up around that strategy. And that transformation, for example, is now firmly focused on the student and student support. There's been some reviews that have been undertaken, and we've uncovered a range of things that are probably typical for a lot of universities, which we're now addressing really strongly. The number of contact points that would be available for a student, for example, we've found more than 25 of them. So if you've got a double degree, you've got two faculties, you've got two help desks, you've got an IT help desk, you've got other things. The number of email addresses, the number of all sorts of contact points. It's quite, as I said, quite typical for traditional universities. So now we're focusing around how that gets streamlined. So there's a range of technology investments that are going in to enable that to occur, and there will be a whole range of streamlined business processes that enable that to occur. So the big question is how much investment is going in? There will be these one-off allocations for these transformations, but it is expected that these transformations will deliver some returns, which in turn helps to fund itself, plus all of the supporting digital capability that we've also got to put in. And so it's really quite significant. I was asked a question before today started, you know, when's a good time? When have you got a break? And I've said, this is not happening. There is no downtime anymore. It's not about a ramp up to Christmas. I can't see a clear pathway when we're not going to be focused on transformation until I can't see it. This is now going to be a continuous process that's really engaging the whole organisation. Everyone is being impacted either directly or indirectly. And I think the staff that are really behind it, because they can see the outcome, will benefit the end client, which is the student. It's going to, as in all transformations, you know, the old story of the caterpillar to the butterfly, it's going to get messy in the middle. It's just messy, but at the end, there will be a very different environment and a much more improved environment. And it's quite difficult to answer the question that's been posed directly, because there are so many range of initiatives that are going on. There are some one-off investments, and we're having to use our existing staff to participate in that transformation, so in-kind contribution, one-off injections of the transformation dollars, and it's also being done in a fairly agile way. So there's no way we can really say, hey, in 6 months' time, we're going to look exactly like this. We have good concepts for all of the capabilities that we will deliver, but through an agile process, we keep putting more clarity on the bone and we keep driving it, and we know that it's not going to stop. We know that it'll just be wave one, most viable product, then the next one, then the next one, then the next one. We are moving away from trying to define big projects, going out to market with all of the 100% of requirements, all fully documented, and then put in a project that doesn't deliver for 2 years. That's not happening. So that's why it's difficult to answer the question. It's a great question, but it's all on our mind. And how do we keep focusing on efficiencies to deliver the right outcome is the question we're trying to address all of the time.
The greater value we provide through that sort of more digital business component, the more money we'll attract. And therefore, we have to be relevant in our business. We have to understand all areas of our business better than we ever have before, and we have to identify those opportunities before they even do. And that's what we've been really focused on. And what a change too for transport and main roads. When I first pulled that team together, the first thing I was told is that no, everyone has to have a desk. Everyone has to have a position description that will align with their level within the team. However, what I wanted and what we did was we attracted people based not only on capability but more on attitude and approach. And we chucked them around a boardroom table. That was their home for 4 months. And you know, we had to obviously, every time HR walked towards that door, we had to sort of get in there and divert them out of the way. But it worked incredibly well, to the extent that when we went into stage two, again, funded by the business, not by my area, we attracted the absolute best and brightest from across TMR to those positions, because they saw what was happening, they saw what you can do. So that's how we have to change as IT providers. We need to move away from that core and really start providing that real business benefit. So.
Yeah, thanks, Andrew. It's a much more complex question for my division, because I'm not like Chris and Martin, so I have a large part of my division which is fee-for-service, being SciTech, ICT and IB, that are semi-commercial providers, and another part of the business which is more administrative in terms of the stuff I'm talking about in relation to contract management, etc., and projects. But if I talk about the SciTech side, so the challenge there is we need to reinvent ourselves, and so having the space, the time and the funds when you're fee for service is a challenge, and so we need to see whatever reserves we have internally
and they're very limited to do that. Notwithstanding that, we have to do that. We have to do that so that we're still relevant for people like Martin, for example. So in terms of those existing services that are there, so there again, that comes down to conversations with our customers in terms of where they want to take that. But there's a large, I wouldn't say legacy, there's a large existing services construct that need to continue to be operating, and so the mass majority of the service delivery organisations like SciTech are focused on service performance there. But what we've needed to do is actually pull a few people out and take a project approach to look at reinventing some of those services. And it's more around a change exercise than necessarily it is technology, notwithstanding that. So technology will be part of that, but it's how do you reinvent, how do you look at different models, different services or different service delivery models. And it's probably not answering your question, but I'm just saying it's incredibly complex and there's not a lot of money around to do that, and you've got to just repurpose what you've got as best you can.
Look, we might just take one more question if there's another one from the floor. Okay, we'll leave it there. Thank you very much, everybody, for attending this morning, and a sincere thanks to our presenters. So Martin, Chris and Dallas, can you all join again in thanking them? So today's presentations will be available by close of business on the Queensland Government Business and Industry website, and the link will be emailed to you later today. You'll receive a survey about today's event. Please provide us with information on your feedback, and that will help us to construct future PiT sessions. As I mentioned earlier, the next PiT session will be held in March 2017, and please go to the website to contact the PiT team for any future inquiries you may have. Can I thank the team for again putting on another professional event on behalf of the Queensland Government and yourselves from an industry perspective. Tea and coffee is available for networking after the event. So thank you very much for joining us here this morning.